Recorded Books Inspirational presents an unabridged recording of Tomorrow's Dream by Janette Oke and T. Davis Bunn, narrated by Christina Moore. This work is copyrighted 1998 by Janette Oke and T. Davis Bunn. This recording is copyrighted 2001 by Recorded Books. Now, with her husband Kenneth beside her to share her joy and oversee the family's legacy, Kyle's life seems perfect. But then a medical diagnosis pulls the thread that leaves the tapestry of her world unraveling around her. And now, Tomorrow's Dream.
Chapter 1. Kyle couldn't help but pause and gaze at her reflection. The hall mirror was at the bottom of the stairs, and she told herself that she needed to stop a moment and catch her breath, which, of course, was silly, particularly since she was descending the stairway. But it was something pregnant women did. They stopped and caught their breath. She had heard it all her life, and it suited the moment perfectly. No matter that she had never felt better or happier. She was 5 months along, and she had every right to stop and catch her breath if she wanted, even to smile in appreciation into the mirror. The mirror was a present from Abigail, Kyle's adoptive mother, and it was one of the most elaborate items she and Kenneth had in their home. Abigail's tastes tended toward the extravagant, and the full-length mirror in its gilded frame overpowered their little Georgetown row house. Abigail checked her appearance in it every time she arrived or departed, usually making some comment about how different this dwelling was from the estate on which Kyle had been raised, or how nice it would be to see this hanging in a larger entryway. Kenneth tended to sigh a lot whenever Abigail came for a visit, and Kyle went back and forth between exasperation and amusement. Kyle loved their little home, almost too small to be called a house. It was connected on either side to dwellings just like it. Three-story wooden structures dating back to a time when Georgetown was a middle-class community in the nation's capital, rather than the newest desirable neighborhood of Washington, D.C. So much was changing as the nation approached the middle of the decade, as though the 60s had determined to redefine everything and everybody, even here. Kyle thought their home was like a dollhouse, her girlhood dreams come true. It was tiny and perfect, and set on a leafy street not far from the shops and the university. Everybody walked or biked in Georgetown. It was a place full of young people and interesting things. Plus, it was the nicest neighborhood within easy distance of her recently discovered brother, Joel. And it was only a quick bus ride, or a long walk, to Kenneth's office in the Rothmore Insurance Building. The time he would have spent commuting was free now to help Joel out with his mission to the homeless and hopeless of society. The thought of her brother caused Kyle to look down at the envelope with the wedding announcement in her hand. Finally, he had asked Ruthie to marry him. Thinking of the young couple brought another smile to Kyle's lips. Joel's heart condition had made him reluctant to burden Ruthie with the uncertain future that marriage to him would mean. But she loved him with a steadfastness that simply would not accept his assessment. She had left her secure world at the Miller farm and joined his inner-city ministry. There she faithfully worked beside him, supporting him, loving him, sharing his triumphs and his disappointments. Silently, she made him realize that she asked for nothing more than to be a part of his life, of his work. Her patience had finally brought him to accept what her heart had been saying. Joel and she were to be married. In Kyle's happiness, she could almost forget that Joel had a heart condition, that his life hung by the slenderest of threads. He had lived far longer than any doctor had predicted, so why not for another 10, 20, 40 years? But this was not the argument that had won him over and finally prompted him to propose marriage. Joel had already learned to live without giving much thought to the morrow, something which Kyle found quite astonishing, as her own dreams were so full of her joy over the future. Joel had finally accepted Ruthie's words as truth, that whatever days were left to them, she wanted to spend together as husband and wife, that she was willing to give her own future over to the Lord their God. It had been hard for Joel, very hard. Watching him come to terms with his own feelings and the worst of his fears had taught Kyle a great deal about this brother she hardly knew. Joel had never been afraid for himself, yet allowing himself to love Ruthie had forced him to ache for what was yet to come. Kyle looked at her reflection once more. What really brought the sparkle to her eyes and the joy to her heart was yesterday's report from her doctor. Everything was going well with her pregnancy. In a very few months, she and Kenneth were to become parents. Kyle had never felt so excited in all her life. It was almost too much joy to contain at one time. A baby. Their own child. Hers and Kenneth's. Something so beautiful to share. So completely theirs. A precious entrustment from God. It was going to be very difficult to wait through the remaining days. Difficult, yet full of exquisite pleasure. She turned sideways so the bulge was more evident in the mirror and caressed her abdomen with the hand holding the invitation. Her baby had been moving a lot that morning, as though impatient to be out and about with the family. The thought was enough to send another shiver of joy through her frame. Kyle's expression, even when she was not smiling, shone with delight over the promise of all that was to come. Her gaze fell on the Bible, still open on the table by the rocking chair. She spoke aloud the underlined words from Psalm 100, which she had read earlier. For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth to all generations. Kyle felt her heart would surely explode with love for God, for Kenneth, for the small person within her. She thought she could actually feel God's love embracing her, holding her close, warming her with his smile. The clock on the living room mantel struck the hour, a reminder that sent her scurrying for her hat and coat and keys. She stepped through the front door, took a deep breath of the fall-laden air, and decided that she would walk after all. She would be a few minutes late, but the doctor had urged her to walk as much as she could manage. And it was a beautiful day, truly filled with all the promise that one future could hold. Her watch said she was 10 minutes late when Kyle entered the Mayflower Hotel's main restaurant. Yet not even the sight of Kenneth's slightly exasperated glance could dim her smile. She hurried over, pulling off her coat and hat to settle them on a free chair. "Sorry, I'm late," she said to the two already seated. "No, you're not," said Abigail sharply. "You're clearly delighted to have caused us to sit here and fume in impatience." But even her mother's crossness was no match for Kyle's exuberance. Abigail turned a smooth cheek to accept her adopted daughter's kiss, then studied her face. "You look, well, positively radiant."
"Thank you, Mother."
Though she had lived through the discovery of her adoption and had met her birth parents, Kyle still called Abigail Mother.
"You are beautiful, as always," she said warmly.
"Nonsense. I'm getting older every day. Age and beauty do not mix. You'll find that out soon enough."
She turned her face away in disapproval as Kyle leaned over, caressed Kenneth's cheek, and kissed him gently. Abigail did not care for public displays of affection. Kenneth ignored Abigail's displeasure from across the table, smiled up at his wife, and said, "Apology accepted." "Really?" noted Abigail. "I fail to see why you two find it necessary to show such sentiment in public. It's simply not done." Kyle slid into the chair between them, took her husband's hand, and cradled it in her lap.
"It is by us."
"Humph. Well, anyway, we've got to get you some clothes. You're not a college girl anymore, Kyle." "I think she looks lovely," Kenneth chided.
Granted, her oversized cable-knit sweater had been borrowed from Kenneth's side of the closet, but her own things were getting a bit tight for her. Kyle gentled her husband with a squeeze to his hand and quipped, "In case you haven't noticed, Mother, I am 5 months pregnant."
"Of course I've noticed. Everyone's noticed. How could they not when you insist on wearing..."
"Mother..."
Kyle said the one word very quietly, but her tone was firm enough to silence even Abigail. Kenneth glanced her way and caught her eye with a quick nod of approval.
Kyle turned back to her mother and asked, "Have you decided about attending Joel's wedding?"
Abigail folded and unfolded her napkin before replying, "Oh, all right. I suppose it's the best thing, really."
"Oh, that's wonderful."
Kyle released Kenneth's hand to give Abigail a hug.
"Did you pray about it like I suggested?"
"Yes, a little, although I can't say I had much of an answer. I find it difficult to understand why God would want to involve himself in such mundane affairs."
"Oh, yes, Mother, he does. Remember the scripture that tells us he knows when a sparrow falls from a tree? And isn't my brother's wedding more important than that? I do think God cares about it and wants you to come."
Kyle beamed at the precise woman seated across from her.
"This is wonderful. I'm so glad you're becoming friends with my other family."
"So am I," Kenneth allowed quietly.
"I must confess that they are quite nice people, especially Harry."
Abigail seemed to compress her lips to hide a smile.
"Although what we have in common, I cannot possibly imagine."
"You have me in common," Kyle gaily declared.
Then, turning to the approaching waiter, she went on,
"I am positively starving. I'll have your daily special."
"Make that two," Kenneth said.
"A green salad," Abigail ordered, "with the dressing on the side."
She turned back to her daughter to say, "Really, Kyle, wouldn't it be wise to watch your weight a little more?"
"I can't. I'm hungry all the time."
"She'll finish her meal and have half of mine, you watch," Kenneth joked.
"The doctor says a healthy appetite is good for the baby, Mother."
"It may be, but you just wait and see what it's like trying to get the pounds off after."
Abigail stared back at the two faces across the table and raised one hand.
"All right, I'll stop. I can see my advice counts for nothing here."
"You're always welcome to offer advice," Kyle said briskly, determined not to allow Abigail to dampen her mood. She fished in her purse and brought out the wedding invitation. "Look what arrived today."
Kenneth accepted the envelope and studied the pen and ink sketch of Joel's mission house. As he handed it to Abigail, his features reflected the concern they all shared over Joel's heart condition.
"I hope they're doing the right thing."
"They are," Kyle insisted, happy for Ruthie, wanting everyone to have all their dreams come true as hers were.
Abigail glanced briefly at the wedding invitation. "It will be another of those simple affairs, I imagine."
"Yes, and you know how much you enjoyed our wedding," Kyle reminded her, sharing a grin with her husband.
"I still say you deserved a big society wedding, and it would have been marvelous to plan."
Then Abigail's face softened at the memory of the event.
"But, yes, it was quite delightful in its own way."
Kyle gave her husband's hand another squeeze. They had insisted on having their wedding at Kenneth's church, which had now become their church home. It had been a quiet and modest affair, but full of shared joy with family and dear friends.
Abigail straightened herself back into her habitual demeanor.
"Which reminds me, Kyle, we were just discussing something of vital importance before you arrived."
One glance at Kenneth's face was enough to tell Kyle what it was.
"Not the church, Mother. Not again."
"Yes, again. I simply fail to see why we cannot attend church downtown together."
"Our own church supports Joel's mission fellowship," Kenneth reminded her, "not to mention being the church I've attended since arriving in Washington."
"All the family attends our church, except you," Kyle added. "And we would love to..."
"I would not be happy there, and you know it. Not a single member of our circle of friends goes there, whereas you have known our church all your life."
Kyle did not mention that her mother had not begun attending church until just a few short months ago, nor that the only time she had herself entered the large city church were for several gala weddings and her adoptive father's funeral.
"We are very happy where we are," she stated calmly.
"Well, if you won't do it for me, do it for your husband. Think of all the excellent connections Kenneth would make there, not to mention raising your child in the proper environment."
"We do not attend church for the sake of business connections," Kenneth said.
The only signal that his patience was wearing thin was a softer tone.
"We attend church to worship our Lord."
Kyle glanced from one to the other, feeling the lines of tension gradually drawing tighter across the table.
Business was a touchy subject between her husband and her mother, and adding religion made for an explosive combination. Lawrence Rothmore's legacy meant that Kyle now controlled a majority of stock in the Rothmore Insurance Company. Kenneth had been employed there for some years and, under Lawrence's tutelage, had risen quickly to a place of responsibility in the company. But the board remained unconvinced that the entire company should be placed in the hands of such a young and untested executive. To have insisted on Kenneth being given the role of chief executive would have cost them many of their large corporate clients, as they would have departed with the disgruntled board members. Besides, Kenneth had explained, holding the position of executive vice president for several years was not necessarily a bad thing. "You can most certainly worship God just as well downtown with me," Abigail retorted, "and do your career worlds of good at the same time." Kenneth started to speak, then paused for the waiter to set down their plates. Kyle used the diversion as a chance to place her hand on Kenneth's arm. When he turned her away, she gave her head a minute shake. When Abigail's attention returned to their conversation, Kyle said firmly, "Mother, we are going to attend our own church. You are welcome to come with us whenever you like. We will be happy to join you from time to time, but our church home will remain exactly where it is." "But the matter is closed," Kyle said, firmness returning to her voice. Looking at her husband, Kyle asked, "Would you say the blessing for us?" Chapter 2. Kyle turned to where her birth parents beamed from the corner of the church's front entryway. "How do I look?" she asked. Martha Grimes regarded her with eyes threatening to overflow at any moment.
"You look wonderful, daughter."
"And big," Harry Grimes added with a grin. "Bigger and happier with every passing day."
"She does not. She looks wonderful."
Harry asked, "How close is it now?"
9 weeks, but the doctor thinks I might be a little early."
"I don't know. I have this feeling it's going to be a girl," Martha announced.
"Don't say that anywhere near Abigail," Kyle warned. "She's absolutely positive it's going to be a boy."
"Oh, pshaw, what does she know?" "As much as you do," Harry reminded his wife.
Kenneth joined the little group. He and Harry both wore the sprig of flowers in their lapels, indicating that they were groomsmen in the wedding and were also ushering guests to their places. Joel had told his father there was no one else he would choose for his best man. Kenneth quipped, "I thought there were supposed to be two of us working here."
"You're doing such a good job," Harry replied. "I felt like I should just stand back and watch a master at work."
"You did not. You're just being lazy."
Martha shook her head in mock scolding. "Shame on you."
"Somebody needs to stand here and hold this wall up," Harry replied.
"Everybody watch out," Kenneth said with a little smile, adjusting his tie. "Here comes..."
"Stop it now," Martha reproved gently, then turned her smile in the direction of the outer stairs. "Hello, Abigail."
Abigail stepped in from the brilliant winter sunlight and had to stop and blink several times.
"Oh, hello, everyone. Is this the welcoming committee?"
"Reinforcements," Kenneth agreed with a straight face.
Kyle nudged him and stepped forward to give Abigail a hug. The woman wore a stunning outfit of midnight blue, set off with a string of cultured pearls.
"You look wonderful." "Thank you, and you look quite enormous."
She frowned as she rubbed the fabric of Kyle's dress between thumb and forefinger.
"I distinctly remember telling the seamstress I wanted your dress done in silk."
Martha's meaningful look drew Harry from propping up the side wall.
"Come on, Abigail, we're holding up traffic here."
He crooked his arm and said,
"Mind if I escort the most beautiful lady here to her place?"
She took his arm and said, "Harry Grimes, don't you dare start on me today. You know what I think about weddings."
"Now let's see."
Harry craned his neck up and down the church, a mischievous grin on his face.
"We've got to set you behind a column or something so you don't upstage the bride. This is your final warning."
But Abigail was struggling to keep her smile under wraps. She pointed down the center aisle.
There. Right up there in the middle. That's where I'm sitting.
Kyle waited for them to move off before saying to her husband, "Why can't you be like that with Abigail?"
"I would," Kenneth replied, "if I could only figure out how he does it."
"That's easy," Martha Grimes responded. "Harry has had a lifetime's experience with dark moods. He's now found a way to put them to good use."
Kenneth nodded slowly. "That proves just how much better a man Harry is than me."
"Oh, you. It isn't that hard."
But Kyle had to smile. The day was just too wonderful, the miracles too abundant. All her family were gathered and happy, friendly and chatting, as families were supposed to be.
"Where's Sarah?"
"She's coming with the rest of the Millers."
Ruthie's younger sister was to be the other bridesmaid. Kenneth glanced at his watch.
"I sure hope they get here before the bride."
"Joel's gone to fetch them," Martha said. "He insisted, said he wanted to be the one to host them here. All but Mother Ruth. She's coming with her daughter."
The pastor slipped in through the side door. He shared a smile with everyone and a handshake with Kenneth.
"Everything all right?"
"It will be," Kenneth replied, "just as soon as the bride and groom arrive."
"Always helps to have them around for a wedding," the pastor agreed.
Patrick Langdon was more than the pastor of their church. He was a friend. He had accepted Joel's mission idea and presented it to the church, then helped arrange for the project to be housed in a derelict warehouse owned by a parishioner. Joel and Ruthie had been busy for months turning the top floor into an apartment. Patrick smiled at Kyle.
"You look happy enough for it to be your own wedding day."
"I'm so glad for Joel and Ruthie," Kyle replied.
He glanced at his watch.
"Well, let's hope they get here in time."
"They'll be here."
"Then I suppose I'd better get myself ready."
He smiled at the next group of people coming in through the doors, patted Kenneth's arm, and moved off. Kyle listened to the talk swirl, watching one person after another climb the stairs and exchange greetings and be shown to their seat. All these people from church, new friends and old, sponsors of the Mission Fellowship, even some of the young people Joel and Ruthie had helped bring off the streets. So much joy, it seemed to Kyle, that the church roof would have to lift off just to hold it all. She glanced down at her dress. She had indeed gone to Abigail's dressmaker, but she had ordered the seamstress to use a delicate chintz for her bridesmaid's dress, not silk. Kyle wanted a dress that would help her fit into the background. This was to be Ruthie's day. Ruthie's and Joel's. Kyle recalled the concern the couple had felt over their decision to be married in Washington. Ruthie was not giving up her Mennonite heritage, but she was working with street people, the flower children who were flooding the nation's capital. Dropping out, that was a term they heard more often each day, some of them dropping until they hit rock bottom. For some, at least, the mission was becoming a lifeline, a last hope. Morning Glory was the name of Joel's project in the Adams Morgan district of Washington, D.C. The mission was growing bigger all the time, with more young people arriving every day. Joel remained a gentle beacon, while his name and that of the center were passed by word of mouth all over the eastern seaboard. Joel and Ruthie had made a wonderful team even before the decision to marry. Her personal warmth and caring nature created an atmosphere of trust for the frightened and often suspicious teenagers who found their way to the mission. It had been hard for Ruthie to go home and tell her parents they would not see their eldest daughter married in traditional Mennonite fashion. But Ruthie and Joel had found a genuine home in this Georgetown church, and Ruthie had wanted it to be the place where she was wed. Kyle had joined Joel in praying for peace and understanding the entire time Ruthie was home. To their surprise, there had been no arguments, no quarrels. Instead, Mrs. Miller had risen as soon as her daughter had finished her explanation and had given her a fierce hug. Then she had said that perhaps it would be nice if they made a wedding dress together, a design that would incorporate the simple lines of their traditional dress, but with a fabric that would be in keeping with her new life. Martha's cry of, "Joel is here!" caused a rush from the vestibule to the front doorway and outside as the mission van's doors sprang open. Kyle felt a moment's pang as she stood there watching the Miller family pile out. The past 2 years had been very hard for them, as it had for the entire Mennonite farming community. Every conversation with Joel and Ruthie seemed to bring with it more bad news. Recently, there had even been some talk about selling a tract of farmland that had been in the Miller household for 5 generations. Kyle hurriedly pushed those thoughts and concerns away. Today was intended for nothing except joy. Sarah, Ruthie's younger sister, wore a lovely frock whose homespun simplicity softened and adorned the strong farm girl in a way that no store-bought dress ever could. Her head was covered by a small, ivory-colored veil, as was Kyle's, both hand-stitched by Mrs. Miller and representing many hours of work. The boys came tumbling out, Simon and Garth and young Jacob, all in their best dark suits and work boots polished until they gleamed. Last of all, Mr. Miller eased his way from the front seat, settling his crutch in place and turning to the church to give them all a smile and a wave. Mr. Miller made his way up the stairs, pausing halfway to point at Kyle and proclaim, "Look at her! Is she not beautiful as the day?" "Sha, Papa, not so loud." But Simon's eyes were on Kyle as well. "A good morning to you, missus. It is grand to see you so happy."
Yeah, what I say."
Mr. Miller climbed the remaining stairs, his crutch and missing limb not slowing him at all. He stopped to tower over Kyle, his beard more silver than black now, but his voice was as strong as the hand that settled on her shoulder.
"I am thinking maybe the sun is rising in your eyes."
Kyle blushed as she put her own hand on top of his. "Today, I am so full of 2 happinesses, I think I can't hold them both. I was so afraid this day would never come."
"You and all the family."
He turned to where Joel had parked the van and was now making his way up the stairs toward them.
"Yeah, that Joel, he run from the altar like a deer from—"
"Papa," Sarah chided, coming up alongside them. "Better we sit ourselves down and pray for the wedding couple."
"A good idea my daughter has."
The hand rose and fell again on Kyle's shoulder.
"Health and happiness, full measures of both, pressed down and flowing over."
Kyle turned back to watch her brother come bounding up the church stairs. There was no indication of ill health that day, not in his beaming face or in the excited energy which filled his spare frame. My brother. 2 years ago she had first learned of his existence, and still the very word sent a thrill of joy through her. Kyle drew back inside the church entryway with a little shiver. The morning frost had been melted away by the brilliant sunlight, but she could still feel the fresh winter chill. Joel entered the church's outer doors, walked straight over, and gave Kyle a hug. She had to laugh. Simple gestures still came hard between them, but today there was no room for either confusion or reserve. Joel leaned back.
"Sorry, did I squeeze too hard, little mother?"
"The baby's fine, and so am I."
She pulled him back for a second hug before releasing him with another laugh. "Blessings on you and on this day, my brother." The Miller's arrival was causing quite a stir among the gathering. Kyle watched the big man proudly lead his boys down to the second row. Simon waited until his father was seated, then placed his wide-brimmed hat on the pew and went over to sit alongside Joel on the front row. Only Sarah remained behind with Kyle in the vestibule.
"All night I spent," she whispered. "All night long I prayed for Ruthie and Joel. I am so glad for them and their new life together. Ruthie has been the happiest person in the whole world since Joel agreed to the marriage," Kyle replied. "You too. You are happy this day."
"Happy for all of us." And then,
"Oh."
Kenneth was instantly by her side.
"Are you all right?"
She managed a wobbly smile for her husband.
I'm fine. Maybe the baby just kicked a nerve or something."
Here they are now.
Sarah pointed out to where a car had pulled up in front of the church.
I'd better go sit down, Martha Grimes said, tugging on her husband's arm. Stand up straight now. Make your son proud.
Kenneth turned back to search Kyle's face.
Are you all right?
He asked again.
Oh, yes, truly it was nothing. I'm just fine.
She squeezed Kenneth's hand on her arm and turned to watch the bride coming up the walk.
Oh, Ruthie, she is so beautiful.
There was a catch in Sarah's voice.
I'm so happy.
Kyle understood what was behind Sarah's worry.
Be happy for her. Yes, of course. You speak rightly.
Sarah took a shaky breath and straightened her shoulders.
This is her day. I must show joy for her and give the morrow over to our Lord.
Ruthie's dress was a work of love. Her sturdy frame was made lithe and delicate by the simple lines and white muslin and organdy folds. The sides and back and veil were embroidered with little cream-colored flowers, and it looked as though the coming spring cascaded and flowed with her every step. Inside the vestibule there was excited whispering. Kenneth offered Mother Ruth his arm. Mother and daughter first exchanged a long hug, and unshed tears gathered in all the watching eyes. Such joy, such fear, such hope. The combination of emotions filled the air in the vestibule. Through a crack in the door, the bridal party watched Kenneth seat Mrs. Miller by her husband. As he hurried back to join the bridal party, the church rustled, full of quiet anticipation, like a forest of trees on tiptoe, waiting to catch a coming breeze. Kenneth paused until the two bridesmaids had straightened the back of Ruthie's dress and taken up their bouquets, then gave Harry the nod. Together, Harry and Kenneth drew open the double doors. The organist had been waiting for that signal and began with a pair of loud chords to alert the congregation. Joel and Simon rose from their places at the front and went to stand beside the waiting minister. The wedding march began, and Ruthie took her first step into the sanctuary. She seemed to float down the aisle, held aloft by the power and the joy which beamed from both her own face and from Joel's. Kyle moved up the aisle behind her, watching the light in Joel's features grow with each step Ruthie took. Ruthie handed Kyle her bouquet, then turned to look into the face of her beloved Joel. Joel took her arm and stood in front of the minister. Then Kyle and all the congregation watched as the light the two of them had brought was joined into one. Chapter 3
Kyle? Honey?
She struggled to open her eyes. For some reason, that simple effort cost her dearly. Kyle focused upon Kenneth's face hovering above her. Worry lines creased his forehead.
How long have I been asleep? She murmured.
I don't know. A while.
He reached down and helped her straighten up. She had slid down the couch until she half sat, half lay, with her back twisted unnaturally.
That can't be comfortable. Let me help you upstairs.
All right.
But rising was an effort, even with him there to support her. The baby had grown until her abdomen felt tight as a drum, and the weight seemed to bear down on her. She stifled a groan as her back muscles tightened in complaint over having lain crooked for too long.
Just lean on me.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.